In the 1920s, the U.S. solved a huge public health crisis with salt.
But how important it is to produce iodized salt. A minute amount of an iodide ingredient is added to prevent simple goiter.
Goiter affects the thyroid and can cause necks to swell, sometimes to enormous sizes. At the time, it was described as one of the most important and widespread causes of human suffering. In May of 1924, the US first sold iodized salt, and just a few months later, Morton Salt was shipping the stuff nationwide. Goiter was no longer a major issue. But that's not the whole story. It also led to a large increase in IQ.
We had a 15-point gap in IQ between parts of the country and other parts of the country. Well, we solved that 15-point gap cheaply and simply. We simply added iodine to salt.
That's Harriet Washington. She's been thinking about poisons in our environment and how they affect our intellectual ability since the 1980s. One of the most common ways to measure intellectual ability is through IQ tests, though Washington doesn't think they're the perfect tool. For one, they've reflected racist and classist attitudes of the day. IQ tests have also been used by some to claim biological differences in intelligence.
They talk about intelligence, but what you're measuring is IQ. Very different things. IQ in this country is meaningful because it measures things that we think are important to intelligence, like literacy, learning words, having a large vocabulary.
But what's considered intelligence in one culture may not be in another. In Kenya, for instance, knowledge of medicinal herbs is seen as the sign of intelligence. But Washington and other researchers think that IQ, over time and at the population level, can be an extremely useful tool to show how chemicals affect people's brain. Which brings us back to iodine. Up until the 1920s, iodine deficiency was common in the Great Lakes, Appalachia, and northwestern regions of the US, collectively called the goiter belt.
Iodine deficiency is very geographic. If you're in a place that had glaciers, the melting of the glaciers washed the iodine out of the soil. If you were living in the upper Midwest, the soil that you grew your food in didn't have much iodine. The water you drank from wells didn't have much iodine.
Certain parts of northern Michigan were so deficient, over 60% had goiter. And iodized salt fixed the goiter problem, but it had an unexpected effect that's been shown in later studies. Take this one led by James Fira. Researchers looked at health records for military draftees from both World War I and World War II.
We basically needed something that was going to get us at intellectual abilities in some fashion. And it gave us this ability to measure how bad iodine deficiency was before the treatment came in.
Of the 2.5 million World War I draftees, 12,000 men had goiter so severe that their neck was too big to button their military uniform. The majority were from states in the goiter belt. These men were also required to take a test to determine whether they would serve in ground forces or air forces when they enlisted. The air force was more prestigious and sought after. Think Tom Cruise and Top Gun.
I feel the need for speed.
The Air Corps is making the claim throughout the war, no, the stuff we do is way more complicated and more difficult, and you guys just walk around carrying guns, so we need the really smart guys. The Army didn't appreciate this attitude towards things, but that's kind of how things went for a big chunk of the war.
So a higher score often meant the Air Force, and a lower score, ground forces. When they analyzed the data, they found that men who were born in parts of the country with low iodine were less likely to get into the Air Force. In fact, after iodized salt was introduced, they estimated that in regions with the lowest iodine levels, there was a real increase in the probability of being assigned to the Air Force. In effect, being born in the goiter belt subtracted 15 points off your IQ.
So why does this matter 100 years later?
Like many scientific discoveries, iodized salt boosting IQ was a happy accident. When countries began adding iodine to salt, they didn't set out to end a major cause of intellectual disabilities. But that's exactly what happened. So if adding iodine increased IQ, could removing toxic substances bump up IQ? Well, yes, take lead. Studies have found that exposure to lead at a young age can result in behavioral problems, learning difficulties, and a decrease in the ability to focus, and a decrease in IQ. The US banned the use of lead in paint and in gas, which led to a decrease in lead levels in blood. But the toxic metal continues to be a problem, particularly for kids in cities, and particularly for black kids. Tests have found that black kids between the ages of 1 to 5 are twice as likely to have elevated blood lead levels. In cities like Baltimore, Cleveland, and Philadelphia, hundreds of kids are still testing positive for lead poisoning. Removing lead from the environment has been more expensive than adding iodine. But there's a lot more at stake.
You know, and money is really important. It will make us economically stronger. But I can't stress enough that studies show repeatedly that very intelligent people in society tend to elevate the society in ways other than economically. And we can't afford that. We can't afford to be left behind.